Hello, my name is Ari Kynäslahti. I'm the CTO of Mobile Networks Nokia. It's my great pleasure to talk today in the 6G Talks webinar. So we are talking about the future radio networks today. So let us start. First, the world's first 6G program, the Flagship program. Nokia has been collaborating with the Oulu University on the 6G Flagship program already quite some time. So we have taken, I would say, a head start globally when it comes to 6G together. You can see here a picture of the car. So that's one of the many use cases of 6G, autonomous driving. But there is plenty more of the new use cases coming with the 6G. Let me come back to some of those. And like I said, we were early starting the 6G Flagship program with the Oulu University, but now it's getting up to speed globally as well. So we have, if we look at the 3GPP world, so it's going to be the release 21 of 3GPP, which will standardize the working items for 6G. And the completion of the release 21 will be at the end of 28. And then we will foresee the first deployments of 6G, let's say mid, late 2029, which is pretty much 10 years after the 5G launch in April 2019. It feels somewhat far away, but then again, it's in many ways also very near. Like I said, the 6G flagship program we have already worked on quite some time. But then also now 3GPP, it's getting their hands dirty. So later this year, early next year, the SOCs will start the work on the 6G requirements. So this is typical. When it comes to the new generation of the mobile network technology, you start from the requirements, the use cases, and so forth. So we will see a lot of work happening on 3GPP as well. But even before that one, we have worked closely with our partners, academia, even our competition to discuss the kind of pre-standard work of the 6G. And this is the reason why we are able to show this picture. I would say the industry is pretty well aligned with the target, the timing of the 6G. So we are all targeting completion of the spec by end of 28. There was some discussion, should we take it later or even earlier? So there are some forces pushing it and pulling it to different directions, but this is now the common ground. We have found a common ground of 6G launch. Standard ready end of 28, and then the deployments starting 29, and then a bigger scale during 2030. Another thing here, you can see World Radio Conference. So this is the ITUT organization globally preparing us for the 6G in terms of the frequencies. So we will need also new frequencies for 6G, and that's very much happening right now. So there is end of November, early December, 4 weeks, a meeting in Dubai, the World Radio Conference, where all the countries will join, and we will start the work on the 6G frequencies. This is super important, because then there is only one more, World Radio Conference meeting 27, and during these two meetings, the work actually happens. Globally, we will need to work out, carve out the frequencies from some other use for 6G. Big, big work. In between, we can see the 3GPP releases 18, 19, and 20. That's the era of 5G advanced. But already with the release 20, the study item work of the 6G will start. As like I said, even earlier, late this year, early next year, we start with the requirements of 6G. So 6G is getting more and more practical. And during the 6G era, we will see a lot of need in terms of the capacity, because the traffic is growing. And if we look at a little bit more in detail, so here we can see the traffic growth in the network. So you can see on the left-hand side of the picture, global mobile data volume. We have split it into fixed wireless access and AR, VR, so augmented reality, virtual reality, and the regular mobile traffic. And you can see 5 times global traffic growth by 2030. And then on the right-hand side, if you look at our typical customer operators of the world, when they entered the 5G era, they had roughly 80 to 100 megahertz worth of FDD frequency assets. And they were running out of capacity with those at the time of 22, on average. And then the 5G came to help. So typically, our customers got 100 megahertz worth of 5G frequency, which means that they doubled their frequency asset, giving them the pathway to grow the capacity for the growing traffic needs all the way until 28. Again, we will run out of capacity. We need 6G. Here, thinking that there would be 400 megahertz worth of new 6G frequency assets, plus the improved spectral efficiency, and we can increase the traffic, sorry, the capacity for the new growing traffic again with 6G quite enormously. So the frequencies, we do need new frequencies for 6G. Here, the green parts are the new frequencies. So something between 6 and 20 gigahertz, it's a kind of sweet spot where we anticipate to find the frequencies for 6G. And then within that one, especially something like from 6 to 8.5 gigahertz, and then again between 10 and 13 gigahertz. So these are the frequency slots globally. We can easily, or let's say a little bit more easier manner, find frequencies for 6G. So this is the World Radio Conference in Dubai, starting their work, carving out the frequencies, especially on those frequency areas. Plus more. So there is the so-called sub-terahertz, which is from 90 to 240 gigahertz frequency. Very much indoor, short range technology, but super important for another important new use case of 6G, which is sensing. So we are going to use the radio as a radar, listening and talking at the same time. We will be able to see objects, people moving inside the buildings, and so forth. You can imagine the ton of new use cases you can be building on top of that kind of a radio. This is the first time ever we are going to use 3GPP radio in a sensing as a radar. Another piece which we can discuss early on at this phase of the technology era is the architecture. We really didn't do a good job as an industry when it comes to 5G architecture. We had 7 options in 3GPP standardization. We finally ended up implementing and deploying 2 of them, non-standalone and standalone. A lot of work, huge difficulty, 2 different set of device capabilities, very cumbersome. Let's not repeat that mistake. Let's do only 1 option, only 1 architecture for 6G. And this is the thinking quite well again aligned with many parties, so that we would be first of all upgrading the 5G standalone core with the 6G extensions. Let's use the 5G standalone core as much as possible, but then again when we have something completely new as a use case of 6G, then it's understandable that we also need the support from the core network, hence the extensions. For the radio piece, I think we did, it's a good idea, the dynamic spectrum sharing of 4G, 5G, but it really didn't work so well. It ended up consuming a lot of capacity. Customers really didn't like it and didn't deploy it in a big scale. But now the benefit is that the control channels of 5G are a lot more flexible than they are of 4G. So this kind of spectrum sharing solution between 5G and 6G, we are able to build a lot better one than the dynamic spectrum sharing of 4G, 5G. We have a new name for it, multi-RAT spectrum sharing. So this is the solution with which we can enable the little bit higher frequencies, the 6G frequencies, you remember from 6 to 8.5 and 10 to 13 gigahertz, those little bit higher frequencies to benefit from the existing frequencies of C-band, 3.5 gigahertz, or the lower DDD bands of 2.5 to 2.3, and even the lower bands of FDD. So we are able to benefit while combining the two. So the multi-RAT spectrum sharing, super important to get it right in terms of the coverage for the 6G. We understand that we need to build the network from the current site grid. So this was the big learning of the deployments of the early 5G. You might remember how some operators had to start the 5G build out with millimeter wave. 24, 28, 39 gigahertz type of frequency assets. They didn't have the C-band when they started to build the network. Good example, Verizon and AT&T in the US. They really tried to build the 5G macro coverage with the millimeter wave, higher frequencies, but it was not easy. It really didn't succeed. And as soon as they got the C-band asset, they went full on with that deployment. Again, we need to respect the fact that the kind of macro site grid, it's a massive gravity in our business of this industry. Our customers, they want to deploy the base stations from the current site grid. So this is one of the big learnings of the 5G. And because of this reason, we will build the 6G products so that our customers are able to put them into the current macro site grid. So exactly the same sites where they today have the C-band 3.5 gigahertz 5G or 2.5 gigahertz 5G. So how do we do it? We need to improve the uplink quite a bit. So we need to put more antenna element than 196 antenna element of typical today's 5G massive MIMO radio, so 1024 for instance. And the good thing is that when you have a higher frequency, like here in a couple of examples, we have the 6 to 7 gigahertz and 8 gigahertz radios, you can see that the dimensions are exactly the same as we are used to, so some 30 to 70 centimeters in terms of size of the box. Because of the higher frequency, we can have the antenna element number increased in the same size, which means we can improve the uplink. We will also improve the uplink in terms of improving the receiver. So this is another big novelty of the 6G. So there is a big research item for the 6G, which is AI, so artificial intelligence-based air interface. Currently, it seems so that it will not be like 100% AI-based air interface, but it will be the classical receiver algorithms helped by the AI algorithms. And this again will improve the receiver side. We can extend the uplink. We can put these higher frequency radios to the same site grid as we have the today's 3.5 gigahertz on. And we have then the target here. So increasing another key factor here is the carrier bandwidth. So today the 5G carrier bandwidth is 100 megahertz. And then the 6G targeting 400 megahertz carrier bandwidth, there is a factor of 4. So 4 times better, 4 times higher. And then improving the receiver side of things with the help of AI and more antenna elements and also more TRXs. So we can then improve the uplink receiver side by the factor of 5. 4 times 5, 20. So this is where we get the target of 20 times better spectral efficiency for 6G compared with 5G. And also another thing we are preparing in terms of the kind of both baseband and radio products already today is the SOCs. So we are already today building the SOCs, which will be in our products a little bit earlier than the 6G starts. So we will have products, submits, which will then be ready with the software upgrade to 6G. So early on, we need to work on the research, standardization, SOCs, architecture, frequencies, the kind of product specification of something you can see here, which is making us enable the smooth upgrade from the 5G networks to 6G. So a lot of work already ongoing on that front. We are not alone, so we are working with academia, our partners across the world. Here some logos, some universities, like the Finnish ones highlighted. Maybe I pick one more outside Finland here, which is the New York University. So we just recently had a Brooklyn 6G summit, and this was now the 10th time we have the summit with the New York University, Nokia and IEEE organized together. By the way, all this material is public, so you can Google Brooklyn 6G summit and you can see all the great presentations and talk we had there just a few weeks ago. And yeah, so 10 times celebration this year for this summit. We used to call it in the beginning 5G summit, and now 2 times it has been called 6G summit. So this was the second time this year when we called it 6G summit. Great event, a lot of university academia joining that one together with the industry and all the players, including the handset side of things, by the way. Good thing to remember, we cannot do the 6G or any G alone in terms of technology upgrade without the chips, the handset side of the community. So Qualcomm's of the world also joining these events together with us. So with this one, I would like to thank you. I hope you liked it. And like I said, please do look at also the Brooklyn 6G Summit material. It's all public and you can find plenty of interesting stuff there in addition to this absolutely fantastic set of material webinar as we have here. So thank you all. Thank you for listening. Have a great day.